Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In our last classes, we discussed about the Biot Savart law, the application of Biot Savart law, and after that we discussed about the Ampere's circuit law. Today we will apply the Ampere's circuit law to a differential surface or a closed path, and we will define the curl. We will discuss about the curl. We completed our study of Gauss's law by applying it to a differential volume element and were led to the concept of divergence. We applied Gauss's law to a differential volume element and we derived the concept of divergence. So we will now apply Ampere's circuit law to the parameter of a differential surface element and discuss the third and last of the spatial derivatives of vector analysis, the curl. Our immediate objective is to obtain the point form of Ampere's circuit law. So, to obtain the point form of Ampere's circuit law or to talk about the curl, we will take a closed path having the sides del x del y, or we can say that we will take a differential area having the area del x del y, or having the sides del x del y, and we will apply Ampere's circuit law to this closed path. Remember that the reference value of h at the center of this closed path is h0 is equal to hx0 ax plus hy0 ay plus hz0 az. And this magnetic field strength is being produced by some current that is yet not defined. So, again, we shall choose Cartesian coordinates. And an incremental closed path of sides del x and del y is selected, as we already discussed. We assume that some current, as yet unspecified, produces a reference value for h at the center of this small rectangle, and that value is h naught. We will now apply Ampere's circuit law to this closed path, because according to Ampere's circuit law, the closed line integral of h will be equal to the current enclosed by the closed path. That is, the closed line integral of h will be equal to the current enclosed by the closed path. So we will take these four sides. We will take this direction from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, and back from 4 to 1. So the closed line integral of h about this path is then approximately the sum of four values of h dot del l on each side. Because if we look at this side, it means that if we move from 1 to 2, so actually we are changing the y component. Similarly, from 2 to 3, we are changing the x component. So, as we know that according to Ampere's circuit law, we have h dot dl. So, del l will be del y. And as we have the dot product in h dot dl, so we will take hy del y from 1 to 2. We will take hx del x from 2 to 3, but with a negative sign, because we are moving towards the negative x-axis. And if we look at this differential area is oriented in such a way that it is directed along the z-axis. So, we choose the direction of traverse as 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 and back to 1, which corresponds to a current in the AZ direction, or the current density in the AZ direction. If we talk about the current density, as the area is oriented in such a way that it is directed along the z-axis, so the current density will be along the z-axis, because we have selected the area having the sides del x del y, so it will be oriented, or it will be directed along the z-axis. So if we talk about the current density, it will have the z component. And the first contribution is therefore h dot del l from 1 to 2 is hy del y. Similarly, by adding all the four components from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4 and 4 to 1, by adding all the four components, it means that by fully integrating this closed path, so it will be the sum of four values from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4 and 4 to 1. So we will get this expression, the closed line integral of the magnetic field strength will be equal to partial by partial x of hy minus partial by partial y of hx into this area del x del y, this differential area del x del y. So this is actually the final result by integrating the magnetic field strength over this closed path, over this closed path. So we will get h dot dl is equal to partial by partial x of hy minus partial by partial y of hx into this area. Now if we look at this expression, by applying Ampere's circuital law, this result must be equal to the current enclosed by the path, because according to Ampere's circuital law, the closed line integral of the magnetic field strength will be equal to the current enclosed by the closed path. So this left hand side will be equal to the current enclosed. So if we express the current in the form of its current density, we know that the current density is the current per unit area. So del I can be written as jz into del x del y. Or the current crossing any surface bounded by the path, as we have chosen this path which is oriented along the z-axis, so we will take, or we will have the z component of the current density. So when we have the z component of the current density, the area will be del x del y, and del I will be equal to jz del x del y, because we have taken this area del x del y, so we will have the z component of the current density. If we assume a general current density j, the current, the enclosed current, is then del I is equal to jz del x del y, and the previous expression, this expression will be approximately equal to jz del x del y, because according to Ampere's circuital law, the closed line integral of h is equal to the current enclosed by the closed path, and we know that the current enclosed is equal to the current density into its area. Now dividing the left hand side and the right hand side by the area which we have chosen, so the equation or the expression becomes the quotient of the closed line integral of h dot dl and the area which we have selected, which we have assumed, and this thing is equal to jz. As we cause the closed path to shrink, it means that the approximate sign can be made more exact by taking the limit. So if we take the limit, this expression becomes more exact. If we take the limit, so this expression becomes more exact. So the limit is the area approaches to zero into the quotient of the closed line integral of h dot dl and the differential area. So that will be equal to jz, and the approximate sign becomes the equality. So now listen, after beginning with Ampere's circuital law, equating the closed line integral of h to the current enclosed, we began with the Ampere's circuital law, and we took the closed line integral of h, and that was equal to the current enclosed. We have now arrived at a relationship involving the closed line integral of h per unit area. The closed line integral of h per unit area enclosed and the current per unit area enclosed are the current density. The closed line integral of h per unit area will be equal to the current per unit area or the current density. Like we took a closed surface, applied the Gauss's law, and we got the point form of Gauss's law. That was the Maxwell's first equation. Here we took the Ampere's circuit law. We applied the Ampere's circuit law to a closed path, and we got the closed line integral of h per unit area. In that case, we had got the closed surface integral of h, the closed surface integral of d per unit volume, and that was equal to the charge density. Here we have applied the Ampere's circuit law, that is the closed line integral of the magnetic field strength per unit area, and this is equal to the current density. If we remind the Maxwell's first equation, or if we remind the application of Gauss's law, if we remind lecture number 6, in that case we had derived the similar expression, the closed line integral of the closed surface integral of the electric flux density per unit volume was equal to the charge density, or the charge per unit volume. So here we performed a similar analysis in passing from the integral form of Gauss's law involving flux through a closed surface and charge enclosed to the point form relating the flux through a closed surface per unit volume enclosed and the charge per unit volume enclosed. Here we have the closed line integral of h per unit area and the current per unit area. In that case, we had the flux through a closed surface per unit volume and the charge per unit volume. So here we have the current density, there we had the charge density. Here we have the closed line integral of h per unit area, there we had the flux through a closed surface per unit volume. In each case, a limit is necessary to produce an equality. If we choose the closed paths which are oriented perpendicularly to each of the remaining two coordinate axes, it means that here we have taken an area which is oriented along the z-axis. If we select a similar area which is oriented along the y-axis and a similar area which is oriented along the x-axis, so we will get the other components of the current density. In order to get the j component, we will select an area which is oriented along the y-axis. In order to get the x component of the current density, we will orient the area along the x-axis. Like in this case, we have selected an area such that it is oriented along the z-axis. So we got the z component of the current density. So in this case, if we orient the area along the x-axis, we will get the x component of the current density and similarly the y component of the current density. Now let's come to the more important expression, and that is vector. Analogous processes led to the expressions for the y and z components of the current density. Comparing 18, 19 and 20. 18, the z component, 19, the x component, and 20, the y component. If we select the area del y del z, the j component will be normal to this area. will be normal to this plane if we select the area del x del z. The j component will be normal to this plane. So we see that a component of the current density is given by the limit of the quotient. The limit of the quotient of the closed line integral and the area. And remember that this component will be normal to this plane. So a component of the current density, a component of the current density is given by the limit of the quotient of the closed line integral of h about a small path in a plane normal to that component, normal to that component of the current density and of the area enclosed as the path shrinks to zero. This limit has its counterpart in other fields of science and long ago received the name curl. So the curl of any vector is a vector, and any component of the curl is given by the limit of the quotient of the closed line integral of the vector about a small path in a plane normal to that component. Exactly the same sentence. And the area enclosed as the path shrinks to zero. It should be noted that the above definition of curl does not refer specifically to a particular coordinate system. The mathematical form of the definition is this. So the curl of H is equal to the limit of the quotient of the closed line integral of H over that area, where del Sn is the planar area enclosed by the closed line integral. The n subscript indicates the component of the curl. That is that component which is normal to the surface area enclosed by the closed path. It may represent any component in any coordinate system. In Cartesian coordinates, the definition 21 shows that x, y, and z components of the curl are given by 18, 19, and 20. And therefore, the whole expression becomes curl of H. If we have the vector field H, so the curl of H is defined by this expression. And the more simplified form is in the form of its determinant. So the curl of H is equal to Ax, Ay, Az, partial by partial X, partial by partial Y, partial by partial Z, and Hx, Hy, and Z. And may also be written in the form of the vector operator. The curl of H is equal to the curl of H. Del is actually a vector operator and H is a vector field. So when we take the cross product of the vector operator del and the vector field H, we will get the vector function. So the result will actually be a vector. Now we haven't physically interpreted the curl. What is actually a curl? Curl is actually the net circulation of a vector field. If the net circulation exists, its curl will exist. If the net circulation doesn't exist, its curl will not exist. If you remember, we had discussed about an equation, the closed line integral of the electric field intensity will always be zero. And here we discussed that the closed line integral of the magnetic field intensity or the magnetic field strength is equal to the current enclosed. It means that the curl of H exists because the circulation of H, the circulation of the magnetic field strength exists. The curl of E doesn't exist. The curl of E is zero. It means that the electric field intensity or the electric field intensity vector doesn't have any net circulation. So this curl actually represents the net circulation of a vector field. Equation 22 is the result of applying equation 21 to the Cartesian coordinate system. Equation 22 is the result of applying equation 21 to a Cartesian coordinate system. We obtained the z component of this expression by evaluating Ampere's circuit law about an incremental path of sides del x and del y. And we could have obtained the other two components just as clearly by choosing the appropriate paths. Equation 23 is a neat method of storing the Cartesian coordinate system for curl. Equation 23. It means that if we express the curl in a determinant form. The form is symmetrical and easily remembered. Equation 24 is even more concise and leads to equation 22 upon applying the definition of the cross product and the vector appeal. Equation 24. Equation 24 is talking about this equation. Is even more concise and leads to equation 22. Upon applying the definition of the cross product and the vector operator. This is actually the representation of the curl in cylindrical form and spherical form. We can represent if the magnetic field strength H is given in Cartesian coordinate system, so we will use this equation. If the magnetic field strength is given in cylindrical coordinate system, and if we have to find the curl, so we will use this equation. And similarly, we can use this equation in spherical coordinate system if we have to find the curl of the magnetic field strength. Although we have described curl as a line integral per unit area, this doesn't provide anyone with a satisfactory physical picture of the nature of the curl operation, because the closed line integral itself requires physical interpretation. So this integral was first met in the electrostatic field, where we saw that the closed line integral of the electric field intensity is zero. And as much as the integral was zero, we didn't belabor the physical picture. More recently, we have discussed the closed line integral of H, that is the closed line integral of the magnetic field strength is equal to the current enclosed. Either of these closed line integral is also known by the name circulation, a term previously borrowed from the field of fluid dynamics. It means that there is no net circulation of the electric field intensity. So its closed line integral is zero. Its curl will be zero. So the curl of the electric field intensity will be zero, because the electric field intensity doesn't have any net circulation. If we take the magnetic field strength H, the H has a net circulation. So that is why its curl is not zero. Its closed line integral is not zero. Rather, it is equal to the current enclosed. So the circulation of H, or the closed line integral of H, is obtained by multiplying the component of H parallel to the specified closed path. By multiplying the component of H parallel to the specified closed path. It means that here we will take Hy del y, here we will take Hx del x, here we will take minus Hy del y, here we will take Hx del x, and here we will take minus Hx del x. So he is talking about this thing. By multiplying the component of H parallel to the specified closed path at each point along it by the differential path length, and summing the results as the differential length approaches to zero and their path and their number become infinite, we do not require a vanishingly small path. Ampere's circuit law tells us that if H does possess circulation about a given path, then current passes through this path. If the circulation of the magnetic field strength possesses, then current will pass through the closed path. In electrostatics, we see that the circulation of E is zero about every path. The circulation of the electric field intensity was zero about every path. A direct consequence of the fact that zero work is required to carry a charge around a closed path. So, we may now describe curl as circulation per unit area. The closed path is vanishingly small and curl is defined at a point. The curl of E must be zero because the circulation is zero. The curl of H is not zero. However, the circulation of H per unit area is the current density by Ampere's circuit law, R18, 19, and 20. So, returning now to complete our original examination of the application of Ampere's circuit law to a differential sized path, we may combine 18, 19, 20, 22, and 24, and we will get the curl of H is equal to curl of H is equal to this equation in Cartesian coordinate system, and that was equal to J. So from this expression, by combining these four equations, these five equations, we will get the point form of Ampere's circuit law. And the point form of Ampere's circuit law is the curl of H is equal to zero, is equal to J. The curl of H is equal to J. It means that when we take the curl of the magnetic field strength, we will get the current density. And this is the point form of Ampere's circuit law, and this is the second of Maxwell's four equation. The point form of Gauss's law was the first Maxwell's equation. The point form of Ampere's circuit law is the second Maxwell's equation. And we will also define the third Maxwell's equation. As I told you that the curl of E is zero, or the closed line integral of the electric field intensity is zero. When the closed line integral of the electric field intensity is zero, it means that the electric field intensity has no net circulation. When it has no net circulation, so its curl will be zero. So the curl of E is zero, and this is the third Maxwell's equation. So the point form of Ampere's circuit law is the second Maxwell's equation, and the curl of E is equal to zero as the third Maxwell's equation. And this was all about the curl. If you have any question, you can ask. Thank you.